Good morning, everybody. In the next 20 minutes, I would, or maybe 15, I would like to show you another evidence of what Holding had said in 1973. And it was about different characteristics of resilience. And one of them was, he said, but he looked at just East, he said that resilience is highly linked to biodiversity, which probably we all know. There was another paper in Science recently. And the second thing he said, we need to manage resilient system at a large scale. And you will see here that this talk is going to go a step further, not just talking about biodiversity, but I'm going to try to show you how this resilience also, and what Holling said, also is something you can see in a social ecological system. And I think I'm in this part of this talk, in this thematic session, just because one of the units we're using is a utility measure. And we measured utility using a choice experiment. And this is going to be our endpoint to measure the change in ecosystem services provision in an economic term. But I'm going to make the leap to show you how, over all the work packages, I think this project has brought us to give an answer to this question. And the question is more, a few weeks ago, I went to the doctor, and there was just a checkup, and the doctor looked at me, and he looked at the value and said, "Ooh, these don't look very great. You know, this could happen, and with these high blood pressure, this could happen." And I was not very interested to hear what he would say, what would happen, but I was more wondering, what could I do now to get to these better values? And that's about the same thing I'm going to show you today, is what can we do now in our exemplar to get this system to provide the services people have demanded. And why do we do this in a mountain region? We have a mountain exemplar, because mountain regions are a little bit like a warning system. They are very isolated, and they're very prone to changes because of their vertical gradients. They're strong vertical gradients. There are two factors which play an important role. One is climate change. And you see here, warming at altitude in the next 100 years. This is a study by Kotowski. And you see here a change in about 5.5 degrees in the next 100 years at an altitude of 2,500 meters. The different colors show the different seasonality. So we have one factor which is really important. Another one is that due to these climatic conditions and the topography of the region, we have a strong farmer abandonment, so people are leaving the farms, and we have a growing of forest, as you can see here. And these are plots of the historical change of land use since 1700 to 2000, and you see here all the different mountain regions in the world, and you see here pink, Sibylle has done the graph, you know that it's always pink. So what you can see here is that the Alps have an increase in forest area. It's 5.5% increase in the forest area since the 1990s. So we really have a strong increase. We have, and it's at the cost of pasture area. And we see that we also have a strong urban change. This influences, obviously, the ecosystem services provided by these regions. And I'm now going to lead you through all the experiments we have done, from plot-scale experiments, which we integrated into landscape models, linked to economical models, to then backcast under different scenarios, what should we do? What kind of management can we do to buffer against these changes? So the first here, what you can see is, obviously, this climate change has an effect on the land and on the species composition in these regions. You see here the Scots pines and the oaks. The oaks have less problems with dryness. And you can see here the pine mortality, red, which is coming behind the drought index you can see here. So they have a problem. They will get, you will see that in included them in the model, you will see that they will disappear with time, these pines, which have an extremely important function in terms of their ecosystem services. And you see that when when we include these kinds of plot scale experiments, we did some other ones with vegetation, where we transplanted certain plots at different altitudes, and we included all these results into three different models. A lot of them are known here, LPJ gas, ForeClim, and LandClim, which were linked together, and these plot scale experiments were integrated into these models. And you can see here the effect on some of the ecosystem services. We looked also at biomass, we looked at carbon sequestration, etc. But you see here if they're integrated into RAMS. RAMS is a natural hazard modeling group of models, a suite of models, which allows you to model, for example, rockfall protection or avalanche protection. And you see the change in ecosystem service provision here, a strong increase or a strong decrease, and you see under two scenarios that we have a change into the red colors here, and the 2 degrees kind of a scenario where we try to decrease 50% of the CO2 emissions in the next years, and you see that if we have no intervention, we'll have a strong increase in avalanche due to a change in the vegetation. Especially at the lower altitude, you can see these changes because, as we can see, these plot-scale experiment results fed into these models change the structure, the composition of the forest, which then has a change on the ecosystem services, and especially also because there's a lot of houses and a lot of objects at risk in these areas. So the question now is, okay, we've seen we have some driver impact on these services, and the question is, can we do something against it? Can we buffer against these changes? What can we do to secure these demanded services? The first thing, again, let's look at the plot scale. Can we do something? Well, let's try with thinning. So we went to our alt-year plot, and we took the stuff out to try to foster certain increment of certain area of certain trees. And you see that if we thin the area, we have an increase in the basal area index. So this is the tree mass. And we see that this lasts for quite a long time. So if we thin our area, we see that we can increase the Scott Pine's growth over time. The problem is, if we include this at the landscape scale, what's going to happen? Are there going to be other trees who are going to take their place? And that's what you can nicely see. So these plot scale experiments were then integrated into the larger scale experiment, into especially here the land claim. And what you can see is this thinning at in 2050, it is going to to encourage Norway spruce for about 50 years. This is a mortality rate. It will decrease, but after that, the effect is gone. And the other species who are more adapted, oaks, Scots pines, oak, larch, and Scots pine, will come. And what happens then, the question is, what happens if you do it now? If you think today, you can see that we can do much better. We can do much better. Here you see also that the Norway spruce will increase for another 50 years. So the intervention, the timing of the intervention, becomes really important in these systems. And when you think we don't know exactly what's going to happen, we have a lot of uncertainties, we kind of need to take certain decisions now to secure certain services in the future. So that's why we tried a little bit more to understand. We said, well, can we now take decisions according to these uncertainties? Is the socio-ecological system and the policy system ready to take decisions, even if we don't exactly know what's going to happen, but we know that we're going to change these services? So what we did is we first tried to understand what do the people want, what do they desire. So we did a large-scale choice experiment where we asked people to tell us what kind of services they would like from these landscapes, from avalanche protection to food production to recreation, etc. So we asked them to trade these off, and they gave us a bundle they would like to have in the future. Based on this bundle, which we measured in terms of utility change to the current situation, it's just a delta utility, it's not an absolute value, it's a delta utility, we then run pathways with our models. So our models told us how this utility is going to change, integrating the plot scale experiment, so integrating the biophysical measure, the socio-ecological measure, and also the economic measure, because these models were then linked to Alwam. Alwam is an agent-based model which tries to allocate economically the management of the farmers on the parcels. So we have a full set of models which try to predict the change in the utility, and then on this we put different pressures and pulses. We put four different pressures. These are global scenarios. You know them. These are the global scenario from the SRES, from the IPCC, with the regional change, the growth and convergence, which is a strong liberalization scenario with a strong economic growth. We have a green growth with more subsidies and local sustainability with a lot of local subsidies and an important push of the local economy. And then on top of this, we said, okay, well, let's have these pressures. Let's put some strong pulses like we had in the last year in the climate. Let's say 3 years of very dry climate. So these are these climate shocks, which are at the top of these pressures. We put these pulses on it. And you see here climate shock, and we also have an economic shock, which is a structural shock. Let's say that the Swiss government does not anymore support the small farmers, and that many more of these small farmers will abandon their farm because they cannot survive together and have certain clusters to have their system functioning. So you see here that we have these global scenarios on pulses, and then we try to understand what kind of policy strategies could help us get the services, the utility we wanted to have. And we have 25 of these policy strategies. We plugged on them. The result, you can imagine, looks like this. So these are all the runs. There are 300 runs of these combined suite of models. And this is the utility change. And the only thing you probably now see is that, this is a lot of runs. And the green runs, some of the green ones seem to function or to create a utility which is not too negative. What you can see is that utility change never gets above zero. So it seems that the current situation, we cannot really get there in the next 50 years. We need to do something. In Switzerland, it seems like even whatever we're going to do, these green areas are all the policy strategies, we're never going to get above a utility change of zero. But you can see that some of these are going to be better than others. And let me go into this. If you look at the runs, all the runs which are down here, which have an increasing loss of utility, are the ones which are under this pressure of growth and convergence. Even whatever policy measure you take under this pressure, you will never be able to get above this level. You see, however, that if we take a local sustainability scenario, there are much more management or policy strategies which can help us buffer against these changes. What happens with the shocks? You see that the shocks are a little bit higher up. They don't have the impact of the global scenario in itself. The global scenario is the growth and confidence scenario is down here. But you still see that structural shock is more difficult to absorb than a climate shock and no shocks. So we see that this combination really gives us some information of where the options of the policy should tackle. Here, the structural shock is going to be a real problem. If we have this, we will not be able to get up here again. This is a structural shock in the system, in the socio-ecological system we have in our exemplar, is going to be really difficult to absorb. And if we go a step further up, is to see, well, what kind of policy measures can really help us to get above here? And you see here that what happens at the moment also, it's a closed market with high direct payment, which is going to help us to be up here. And if we have no direct payment, we're going to go into a more loss of the utilities. I was also talking about, well, do we need to do that now, or can we wait? then take a decision later on. What you can see, if we wait, we have an even bigger problem. Here you see these different policy strategies and when they come into play in the system. And you see here the dotted lines. If I take the decision right now to intervene in my system, I get much better utility than if I wait and I intervene down here. So you see the timing of the intervention in the system is really important. So the message is we need to take decisions now, even if we don't know exactly how this system is going to evolve. Furthermore, these results are extremely context dependent. You may say, okay, well, let's move to another system and look how it looks like. We did exactly the same experiments, from the plot scale experiment to the integration large scale model in another area, and I don't want to go into detail here, but what you can see, this is another mountain range in Switzerland, the Jura, and what you can see that the timing of implementation, you see here the different scenarios, and you see that the timing of implementation has an effect on the utility in the valley, but has a much stronger effect in the Jura. And why is that? It's because the Jura is much further in the development of the forest area. We have seeds in the soil, which even now, if you manage, you need to manage very quickly now to get these seeds out or to get the trees out of the system to have these open areas to produce the service they want. The system needs to be changed drastically at the moment to have really a decrease, and so it reacts much faster than the valley. On the other side, these interventions are, or the timing is extremely dependent on what kind of intervention you have. If we take intervention on a large scale, for example, spatial planning, which I didn't show before, but you can see here, the effect of a restrictive spatial planning is extremely effective if we take it now compared to structural intervention, which I showed you before, which is less effective. And what this shows very nicely is that these large scale intervention in the system are extremely effective to support the services people demand. So finally, you might wonder, well, what are the characteristics of the system? And when I go to the doctor, what are the characteristics I need to get to, you know, to decrease my blood pressure, whatever I have? Is exactly the same question here. What characteristics does this social ecological system need to be able to buffer against this change? And what Holling said, that's exactly what we see here. We need a high diversity. But on the other side, what's really interesting is that directly correlated to this, we need a diversity of factors, not the number of actors, not the numbers of farmers need to be increased, but their diversity. We need to have extremely high diverse people in this region to carry on certain management practices which support the services, not the number. It's really the diversity. So in summary, yes, we can do something to increase the resilience to not extremely high global change, but to weak global change by doing the three things. First is to manage at the landscape scale, to make sure that we have an early intervention and that we are sure that we secure the biodiversity of the actors and of the ecological system. Otherwise, we get into this other state, which might be a state which is acceptable, but that is the state people in the choice experiment expressed. And so we tried finally to get people to understand this, and we created this nice information, because we are working in opera and we tried to operationalize what we found out, so we told them all about our system, about the changes, etc. And we gave them this kind of platform you see here, which was developed by Tom using eye tracking experiments. He tried to understand what kind of information do they need to understand the system. And you can see them here work with the stakeholders. We did this iteratively a few times in workshops. And what I have to say is that we measured if their system knowledge had changed. And we could say, yes, their system knowledge had changed, but we still don't know, and we are trying now to understand if we can get some more information on that. We don't know if this knowledge they have is going to be translated into practices, into farming practices, which need to react now, as we saw before that we need to intervene now, and that's our follow-up project we're doing now. We're trying to understand the acceptance of the measures and if they're doing something in reaction to this change in systems.